everything I like. Darling with you. To man. calling one and all. Strike up the band. There is work to be done, to be done. There's a rest to be won, to be won. Come on, son of a son of a gun. Take your stand. Come along, let's go. Hey, Mr. Striker. And when the drums go out, out before, while the tears strike up the band.
nice world if you can get it, and you can get it if you try. Just imagine someone waiting at the cottage door, where two hearts become one. Who could ask for anything more? Loving one who loves you, and then taking that vow. Nice work if you can get it, and if you get it, won't you tell me how that works? Likewise, the man who works for fame, there's no guarantee that time will erase his name. The fact is, the only work that really brings enjoyment is the kind that's for a girl and boy then. All in love, you won't regret it. That's the best kind of work if you can get it.
Where my home goes. Thank you. One little day, a little song.
be sad, let me add, they were nothing more than just men. Darling, can't you see? Was for charity. Though these lips have laid slips, they were never really serious. Who'd have thought I'd been caught in a state that's so great, whatever thing I
Thank you. work in charity and a good cause. For the singers and the dancers who spent many hours over several weeks in rehearsal at the same time as carrying on the dance.
Is this of youth in the grip of a mass dancing hysteria? Biggest jam session ever held. Seldom has America witnessed anything quite like this exhibition of midsummer swing madness.
It was born half a century ago in the nightclubs and ballrooms of Harlem. a new dance to go with a new kind of music. The new music was called swing. The dance went by many names, from the Lindy Hop to Jive. But most people called it Jitterbug. If there's such a thing as a classic American dance, the Jitterbug probably deserves the title. People of all ages dance it in every part of the country, and everyone gives it their own individual twist. In Jitterbug, the more ways you can move to the beat, the better.
Keep doing it, you just want to do it more and more and more and more. Sometimes your job suffers.
Understanding of the dance, you have to capture the spirit of it. Live musicians playing for live people, and the spirit of it comes out.
Unlike many ballroom fads, Jitterbug has retained its popularity over the years, and it's still being danced by some of the men and women who helped make it famous. People like Norma Miller and Frank Manning.
You can dance the Lindy when you're 70. You can't do a lot of other dances when you're 70. It's impossible. You can always swing, because the swing is perfect. Dancing gives the world pleasure. And who was it created by? You still have a few of those left that were probably the creators. All of this went down 50 years ago. For something to sustain 50 years, it had to have a lot of substance.
Frank and Norma are now in their 70s. Not quite as acrobatic as they used to be, but every bit as smooth.
That's what I enjoy. I love to hold a woman in my arms. At those particular moments, me and my partner are in love with each other. I don't think you ever see a Lindy Hopper that's not smiling. When everybody was feeling low, it was a dance that was a happy dance that would get people together.
The black teenagers who danced it in the late 1920s called it the Lindy Hop. It was yet another outpouring of that era of creative ferment known as the Harlem Renaissance.
In Harlem at the Savoy Ballroom, that was our niche. That belonged to us. And everybody came there. People used to stand outside the Savoy Ballroom just to watch the people go in. And they came there with the best they had. You would walk in, and this is this long ballroom, and from one end of the ballroom to the other were people dancing.
There is rhythm and the Lindy Hop at Harlem's land of swing, homeland of happy feet.
I think I was in my 20s before I realized the rest of the world in this. I just never knew anybody who wasn't a dancer.
Loose-jointed girls and boys made of India rubber.
Every Saturday night on the floor of the Savoy Ballroom, Harlem's best dancers competed against each other for a $10 top prize. So everyone was always on the lookout for a new wrinkle, a different step.
There's somebody standing on the side just watching you intently, you know, saying, yeah, I see that. Yeah, I'm gonna get that. You know, one of those things like that. If it's good, great. Maybe you change it around a little bit. Maybe you do it backwards, you know. But then that person see that step again, he say, hey man, that's a great step. Where'd you get it from? He say, oh, I got it from you.
Then Frank Manning had an idea that would revolutionize the dance, a step that would become a trademark of the Lindy Hop. He called it an aerial.
The very first time I did it was in a contest, and in dancing, we come into the last step. And I said to my partner, I said, Frida, this is it, shall we go for it? So she said, yeah, let's go for it. It seemed like the whole Savoy Ballroom, who were experts in Lindy Hopping, they arose as one and said, oh, they just started to screaming and hollering and jumping and stomping and carrying on. then I said, oh, well, maybe we're onto something.
What they were onto was a dance that would soon move beyond the confines of Harlem and begin to excite audiences and dancers in white America. The vehicle for Jitterbug's burst of popularity in the late 1930s was a group called Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, carefully assembled from Harlem's ballrooms by a street fighter turned dancer named Herbert White. Whitey.
I worked with Whitey when I was 14 years old. I had won a contest. And he saw me dance in a contest. He brought me to the Savoy. He saw Frankie dance in the ballroom one time, and he saw Frankie and get after Frankie. He knew what he wanted.
What Whitey wanted was to showcase the Lindy Hop, not only in America, but in nightclubs around the world. For that, he needed dancers like Frank and Norma, and he got them.
We just had a charm life. When you're young, and you, somebody saying you're going to Europe and you're going to Paris, and oh my, I mean, are you, do you, you're 15 years old. So I said, this is the life for me. You mean to tell me I'm getting paid, I'm dancing, and I'm seeing the world? Life is perfect.
This is Norma Miller doing a move called Handspring Down the Back. One of Frank Manning's trademarks was a step he called the snatch.
Whitey saw more than just a ballroom dance, because he knew our capabilities long before we did. Because on that, we would have just fluffed it off like any other dance. You know, it was just a dance in the ballroom. He made it more than that. He made us, he gave us a sense of destiny.
Thomas Carnival of Swing, playing in relays, 30 famous bands fill the air with hot rhythm for 6 solid hours. To these 30,
this was black music. Like a glimpse of the bomb, and we were the dancers that went along with that music. See, we went into places. We played Radio City. We played the Rainbow Room. We played areas where our dance was so popular. They had to accept us. And that was how America got exposed to swing.
Swing It Honey Child, Susie Q's Going to Town, and How.
With white audiences falling under Jitterbug's spell, it wasn't long before the news reached Hollywood, a town with limited opportunities for black performers.
Hollywood called Whitey here in New York at the Savoy and wanted us for the movie. That was when you know you've arrived, when Hollywood called you. We didn't go looking for that job.
Man, don't stop now, we've done it.
That job eventually led to the most famous Lindy Hop dance sequence ever filmed. A scene of such exuberance and artistry that it transcended the demeaning black stereotypes of the time. The movie was called Hell's a Poppin'. Here, Norma dances with Billy Ricker. Al Mims performs his specialty, a Charleston move called Crazy Legs with Willa Mae Ricker. And for the finale, Frank Manning and Ann Johnson did an acrobatic hoedown that featured some of the group's most show-stopping air steps.
I've had 50 years to look back and said, I mean, you'd have to be crazy to do what we did, you see? But we did it because we loved it. We had been so in tune to each other. Remember, we lived together, slept together, worked together. We were as best as we could be. I don't think we've ever been better. That's what we did. That was ours. It was a very fabulous group. It was the best group that ever was in Lindy Hop.
It was also the beginning of the end. The war came. Race riots erupted in Harlem. The music began to change, and so did the dances. For Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, the golden era of swing was over, at least for a while.
Rock step, kick, step, kick, and step, kick.
Warren Hayes and Carlene Hines are members of a British dance troupe called the Jiving Lindy Hoppers. They've come to the States for a series of workshops and performances aimed at a new generation of jitterbuggers.
The first thing you've got to do when we're learning the Lindy Hop, which is the grandfather of all the jiving, isn't it, yeah? Well, we call it jive, you call it jitterbug, yeah? Not only is it up here twisting and spinning, but it's also down here, so you can combine the two, yeah? Much more fun.
Strange right? As it seems, the jiving Lindy Hoppers first learned the dance from watching Frank and Norma's old movies.
The impact of Hell's a Poppin' was wow. I mean, I couldn't speak. I just saw it and absorbed it all.
I just thought it was amazing. I just thought it was wonderful. I looked at it and I thought, oh my goodness, I'll never be able to do that ever.
I thought it was quite amazing. I said, you mean to tell me you sit in front of a camera, in front of a TV, and you do all of that, and you learn how to dance on that? I said, man, I thought it was stupendous.
In 1985, the Jiving Lindy Hoppers finally met Frank and Norma, still swinging out in New York nightclubs.
And actually going over there and meeting them, just seeing them still dancing, and still dancing well, was a real sort of satisfying feeling, like, well, this is it, this is where it's happening, and this is what I've got to work towards.
What they had to work towards was finding the soul of the dance. The part that lay beyond counting beats and fancy footwork.
I remember once Norman Miller got so angry with us because I was saying, but what beat do you call it? Because, you know, we Brits, we're very, very technical. You know? we like to count things out, you know, and get it right. You know?
Because if you start counting and talking like that with me, I don't talk to you. I talk only at the level where the music is. But you notice when Frankie swing out, it's got that marvelous long line like a... Everything is so symmetrical, and if a dancer could just get that swing, when you see a person that every part of his body moves to the music. Dancing swing is not just dancing, you've got to hear the music. I think the best thing now is that they're being exposed to Frankie. That's going to do more than all the counting in the world. And Frankie does spend a lot of time with them. And that's the best thing they can do. I tell them, I said, watch Frankie. You got the best teacher in the world.
Today, the Jiving Lindy Hoppers spend much of their time on tour, recapturing some of the excitement that electrified the Savoy Ballroom 50 years ago.
Once you're in there amongst a live band and live dancers, one feeds off the other. You know, the musicians feed off the dancers feed off the musicians.
You feed off the audience, you feed off the atmosphere, you feed off the music.
It's incredibly infectious. I mean, it just keeps you going, the beat.
People go away and they're just so happy you've brought back a memory for them, you know. An old person said, oh, that brings back lovely memories.
It's keeping swing alive. You can't have enough dancing in the world as far as I'm concerned. And I'm glad that somebody wanted to pick up the gauntlet and carry on the work.
It's authentic jazz. It's a connection right across time, isn't it? Other people can't recreate what I've experienced with the old masters. I suppose that gives me a burning desire to teach them as well as I can, you know, in my own small way, really, to do that, to repay.
You can share something, you bring something new into someone else's life. Bring them a bit of joy, which is what everyone needs.
Mm-hmm. Since dance is a hand-me-down art form, it always needs someone to hand it down to. People like Mickey Davidson and Clyde Wilder.
And to see Frankie and him do it, just the excitement that comes from them. Just like we hope the excitement comes from us and spread to everybody else.
We're just kind of trying to follow in the footsteps of our elders. Because if it's good for them, it's good for me.
I love Frankie like he's just the most important man in the world to me. I just think that every time we look at each other, when, you know, the last funeral we went to was my dancing partner. Billy and I have been together 30 years. And when we went to, we was at the casket looking at Billy, and it was me, Frankie, and there was Billy laying in the casket, and we knew there's only two of us left. Sort of makes you feel sort of strange, because you wonder, is the case of playing musical chairs? Like you say, I say, hey, how do you feel lately, kid?
Sometime, well, she may be a girl, but she comes to see me sometime. Well, she comes so often, I'm beginning to think she's mine. Well, she's yours and she's mine, and she's somebody else's too. Well, she's yours and she's mine, and she's somebody else's too. Well, if you don't mind, I'll have her clear away from you. Well, that girl rocks me. She rocks me with one steady roll. She rocks me. She rocks me with one steady roll. And when she rocks me, light it satisfies my soul. Oh, your side. Well, if that's that's your girl, you better tie her to your side. Cause if she comes around me, well, I'm sure I gotta let her ride. Well, she don't drink or gamble, and she don't run around, but when it comes to good loving, she can really go to town. That's the truth, baby, I swear I wouldn't lie. If I don't love my baby, gee, I hope to die.
The rock and rolling of the jiving Lindy Hoppers. The tidal wave of rock and roll broke over us in the 1950s, but here in Britain it all happened so fast that we were left out of the basic understanding of where and how it all began, and what a lot of it meant. For instance, what was Fats Domino singing about in his hit Be My Guest? We're gonna Lindy Hop and Susie Q. And how did that relate to the jivers in that amazing dancing sequence in the Marx Brothers film A Day at the Races? Those were some of the questions that fired Terry Monaghan to go on a quest in search of the origins of jive, the elusive Lindy Hop. He joined up with fellow enthusiast Warren Hayes, and with the aid of a bank loan, headed for New York to track down surviving original dancers like Mama Lou Parks, Frank Manning, Norman Miller, and Pepsi Bethel. And at their feet, Terry and Warren soaked up their collected knowledge, which enabled them to pass on that essential ingredient, original style.
Look at here, Sophroni, have you got a dollar on you in the state of California? If it is, I'd like to know. I want a little girl to be all mine in the winter time. Raining and the snow starts snowing. You reach up and turn on your radio. Look at Jack, you better take it slow. Cause the chicks are raring to go. Well, you reach under the bed, grab a jug, take a little nip, get rid of the mug. Look at your girl, you kiss her and you send her, make a holler, make a holler.
Ice cream.
After mugging, shoot the liquor to me, John Boy. Take a tip from me, she's sweet as my Sophronia bee. Take a tip from me, she's sweeter than my Sophronia bee. Oh, she's sweeter, she's sweeter, sweeter, my Sophronia bee.
That was the Big Apple, the Lindy Hop version of the Virginia Reel. Did you recognize steps like the Applejack, the Stomp Off, the Skate, the Charlie Chaplin, the Boogie Back, the Flea Hop, and of course the Susie Q? Terry Monaghan and Warren Hayes became addicted to the dance styles of Harlem in the 1930s and 40s. Warren is probably the best dancer to emerge from the rock and roll revival. And in forming the jiving Lindy Hoppers, they managed to attract some of the best professional young dancers around, who bring their own special talents to the company. Black dancers of the group crossed the generation gap and particularly impressed the New York old-time hoofers. Pepsi Bethel explained that the Lindy was not just the first form of jive, but the culmination of the American social dance tradition that began 150 years before on the slave plantations of the Deep South. The seed of jazz dance was sown when the black slaves took the mickey out of the fashionable court dances of their white so-called masters. They say that the cakewalk was given its name because of competitions to win cakes. Well, whether or not that's true, it started the minstrel tradition. White entertainers began to black up and imitate the performing slaves. And so began a tradition that lasted over 100 years. Now, believe it or not, even black performers blacked up at first, but began to abandon this racist stereotyping as the African cultural heritage slowly emerged. Black minstrels borrowed from other cultures as well. For instance, they use Irish step dancing to explore an infinity of rhythms around the basic European beat.